as he did Adam in Genesis. He, oh, Jesus. Come on, just breathe in now. Breathe in the air that he's given.
Father, we thank you, Lord God, for all the listening ears that you have given unto us tonight, Lord God. Because, Lord, we came to demonstrate the who you are, Lord God, to anyone that's willing to receive the engrafted word that they dare to hold on to. So, Father, we thank you tonight for allowing us to have this day, Lord God. And we went through this day, Lord God, not having the difficulties that the enemy would want to bring to us, Lord God, but he couldn't, because you are Lord over our life. And Father, when you're Lord over our life, Lord God, every part of our life that we yield to you, Lord God, the enemy in no wise will come and try and master over. So Father, we yield our weaknesses to you. So as we yield it to you, Lord God, then are we strong, Lord God, because that area be built up, Lord God, in such a way that the enemy dare not try to attempt to break through, to do anything. So, Father, we thank you, Lord God, as the folk that are listening to us, Lord God, and those that are here with us, Lord God, we ask that something be said, something be done, the anointing rise up, Lord God, and that anointing that will be able to change, to transform, to heal, and to deliver, in Jesus' name. We say amen and amen. Hallelujah. Tonight we are on a broad topic. And the reason why I say broad topic, because there's a place that we want to go. And I don't want to just go there, but I want to go there through different scriptures, you know, because the Bible says we learn from line upon line, and precept upon precept, here a little and there a little. And it is so true that we do need to have a precept. We do need to have a line. And we do need to layer them upon one another so that they can identify with one another to tell us that this is the truth that we're walking in. So, Father, let us continue to walk this way. You know, we're talking about tonight and in the days and the teachings to come. We're talking about authority and power. And I think the greatest tragedy of a Christian life is those that don't understand authority and power. You know, even I myself sometimes, you know, would doubt the power that God has given me. I didn't understand all of the ability and all of the might, and I'm starting to truly come into the knowledge of how powerful we are. You know, so there's, as we go through this teaching, we want to take apart there are more than four, but I want to take apart four Greek words that will bring an understanding, a better understanding, as to what this authority and power is. And those three Greek words is dunamis, exousia, ischus, and kratos. voluminous, explosive, exousia, changing circumstances, ischus, doing supernatural human things, and kratos, the ability to be outside of yourself and not even know that it's you, but it's you that God is using. You know, and how you spell those words, dunamis, D-U-N-A-M-I-S, dunamis. Some say dunamis and dunamis. I don't know how you want to pronounce it, but I say dunamis. And sometimes I say dunamis. And exousia, E-X-O-U-S-I-A, exousia, E-X-O-U-S-I-A. If you can get Greek and Hebrew dictionary, and look these words up, it will do something to you for real. And we're gonna go through these, and we're gonna see why the church today is not where it needs to be, because we don't teach on these abilities that's wrapped up in the power. And ischus is I-S-C-H-U-S. Ischus is I-S-C-H-U-S. I-S. And then kratos is K-R-A-T-O-S. Kratos. Amen. Those are the three that we're going to expound on. I mean, the four that we're going to expound on as we go along this journey. You know, and I just want to start out right now in the place of a question that was asked, you know, and I want us to look at Psalms 8:4, and then we go to Hebrews 2:6. Psalms 8:4. Psalms 8:4. And in Psalms 8:4, there's a statement in 8:4. Let's start out. Just read the whole from 1 all the way down to 6. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent what is thy name in all the earth. Who has set the glory above the heavens? Out of the mouth of babes and suckling has thou ordained strength. You know, and out of the mouth of babes and suckling, I'm just saying that God put this thing inside you when you were a baby. If a baby wasn't saying goo, goo, gag, gag, whatever, he'd be saying the word of God, and the word of God will come alive in that child's mouth if he could say it. Because as soon as he can talk, you understand what they're saying. And guess what? God understands them too. Soon as they talk. So he goes on to say, out of the mouth of babes and suckling hast thou ordained strength because of thine enemy, that thou mightest steal the enemy and the avenger. When I consider the heavens, the work of thy fingers, and the moon and the stars which thou had ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man that thou visited him? For thou hast made him a little lower than angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honor. Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hand. Thou hast put all things under his feet. Has put all things under his feet. Now, all of what we're going to be talking about with this authority and power is hinged upon this very fact of what he said right here. And I think a lot of times we read this and we don't really understand what he's saying here. As a matter of fact, when I first read it, I was confused, because he was saying, thou has made me a little lower than angels. I said, man, wow, well, I know angels are supernatural beings, and I read in the Bible where angels excel in strength. So, man, I guess I am a little lower than an angel. You know, but the Bible, when you take it apart, it talks about made the word angel, and here in this context, made him a little lower than Elohim, which is God, made man a little lower than God. And we went over this in some times past, but I want to read another version of this, and I want to show you something different as what the writer in Hebrews has said, you know, that made this thing a little gave it a little twist, and that is in Hebrews 2. And then we'll look at Hebrews 2, we'll look at verse 6, and we'll go from 6 to 9, you know. And I need you to just be attentive. He says here, "But one in a certain place testified, saying, What is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visited him? Thou hast made him a little lower than angels. Thou hast crowned him with glory and honor. Thou didst set him over the works of thine hand." Now, push pause for a minute. Now, he did not give the angels any glory. He did not put the angels over the work of his hands. They're not over the work of his hands, you know. And he didn't crown them with glory and honor. Now, but I'm going to show you something that's even will bring you closer to home. Verse 8, "Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet." You know, this is identifying who you are as a spiritual authorized person here in the earth. So he's put all things in subjection under him. In other words, all things are under you. All things are under me. And as we understand what they're saying, the greater our walk will be and the more mightier we will be other than what we think we are. So, he left nothing that is not put under him. So in other words, there ain't nothing that's loose that's going to be surprising that's not under your subjection when you recognize who you are. Everything is under your subjection. If you will pay attention, as you would have read the Bible, as you read the Bible, you know, Joshua that made the sun stand still. Who was it that made the moon stand still? And while he was having a battle, which one was that? Elijah. Yeah, I know one of them prophets. Now, well, he the pastor. He don't know. Y'all, keep on. Stay right there. Stay right there with that. But he spoke to the sun and made it stand still while he was fighting a battle, and the sun did not go down for that space of time until he was done doing what he was called to do. And then God had another one to speak to the weather and tell the weather to not give any rain. Elijah? It was Elijah? Okay, Elijah. See, Elijah. You know, Elijah. And I wasn't lying to you. It wasn't Elijah to you. You know, and so he even had him, you know, and then he had Elijah to outrun a chariot, you know. And these things that have been done, you know, believe me, still can be done. You know, we're going to talk about some things, though. We're going to talk about some things. So he didn't leave nothing that was not put under us. But now we see not yet all things put under him. But watch this part. This is what I want you to see right here. Verse 9. He says, "But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels." Now, wait a minute now. If it was actual angels, you know, so you know he wasn't talking about Jesus, angels being above Jesus, Jesus being below the angels, and he's putting us in that same category, which lets you understand that he was talking about himself, the angel, a little lower than Elohim, a little lower than God himself. It was Elijah, right? Joshua. Was Joshua? Okay, Joshua. I did say Joshua, Joseph, or somebody. I know it was a J somewhere in there. Jacob. Boy, look here. It's all right now. I still know who we are now. You know. So he says, "But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor." The same thing he's saying about man, that he said about Jesus, he's saying the same thing about man. So it's letting you know that he's paralleling you with a man, with Jesus, putting you on the same plateau with Jesus, huh? So he says, crowned him with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. Amen. Hallelujah. Now let's go on. Let's. Now that was the order of that. Let me put that in a understanding. You know the order. You know, and you got to recognize this. Whenever you come into a challenge, you have to recognize the who you are. You know, this is what we have here. We have God, and then we have man, and then we have the angels of God, the host of heavenly angels, and then we have demonic angels at the bottom. That's why he says all things are under our feet. If there's any negative thing that's going to be brought into your life, it's going to be brought into your life by these demonic angels. God angels not going to bring you anything negative into your life. God himself is not going to do it. So it's the enemy that's going to bring anything that's negative into your life. It's going to be the demonic, occultic world that's going to do this. And so that means now he told you that everything is put under your feet. He had left nothing that wasn't put under your feet. And the last enemy that was needed to be put under our feet was death, and Jesus took care of that. Yeah. That's the last enemy, was death. So Jesus took care of death. So that means now death no longer is a threat to those that know their God. Hallelujah. Okay, now let's talk about a little further into this authority. Authority is has to be given. And not only authority is given, it has to be accepted. If you don't accept authority that was given, let me have, isn't the umbrella right there in that corner right there? Let me get that umbrella for a minute. If you don't accept the authority. No? Okay, somebody done moved it. You got one? Okay. If you don't accept the authority that was given to you, guess what? You don't have no authority. Even though that authority exists, you don't have it. Because you never accepted it. If you don't acknowledge and accept the authority of the police department, eventually you're going to wind up breaking the law. Why? Because you don't acknowledge the authority that you should be. Oh, big one too, boy. That you should be under. You know. Now, she just brought this umbrella to me, and let's just say this umbrella represents the power of God, and that's his anointing. And let's just say the rain and the weather is the enemy. So when I come up underneath, now y'all know when y'all walking in the rain with an umbrella, you know, you know certain part of your body is going to be dry, but there's going to be still some parts going to get wet. No matter how much, if the rain start going a circle, I don't care if you do like this, the rain's still going to get you. It's still going to get you, you know. So some of it's going, the Bible says we live in a sinful world, so some sin going to get on you. So then, but you with the umbrella, and the part that the umbrella really is protecting is your head and your chest and this part of your body. Isn't that the important part?
Yes.
You know, but if I were to come out from underneath this umbrella, I will start to get soaking wet. Or if I just neglect the umbrella, I will start to become subject to what the umbrella or the authority that once was protecting me no longer has the ability to protect me. Why? Because I would not submit to it. If I submit to it, now it can do for me what I can't do for me. I can't keep me dry walking out there in that weather. All out there in the rain and stuff, you know. I'm out there in the rain, you know. And I'm just getting soaking wet because I refuse to submit to an umbrella. So then when we refuse to submit to God, we're under the elements of this world. And it's nothing God can do to help you until you submit under the authority of who he is. And once you do, you know for a fact, I don't care how it rains, it's not going to get to your head. That means what you believe and how you thinking, he can't mess with your head because his head is still dry. Your chest of how you believe it is going to still remain the same. And all the truth of who you are going to still remain dry. Why? Because the umbrella is helping. Now, my feet might get wet now, and I might mess around and make a mistake and go the wrong place, but I can always straighten out because the rest of me didn't want to make that mistake, so I can redirect myself back to where I need to be. Why? Because the most valuable parts of me is still covered and still under the we're going to leave that right there. Yeah, it does. Look at that. She got that umbrella to match me. So then we want to see something, you know, that a lot of Christians, I don't think we take out the time to see. I want to say this on a personal like note. It's so important that we meditate on the word of God. It's important. I don't care what anybody say, you have to find time to meditate in the word. And you know, it doesn't have to be you sitting down inside a chair and just meditating. I meditate all day. You know, I might get a word inside me and I might start talking about that word to God all day. I'm riding in the car, you know, I'm picking up, you know, dropping somebody off, I'm riding, and I'm meditating on a word, you know, that God, I'm saying God, you know, and I'm talking about that word, you know, that's meditating on the word. That's giving time to God. You're not thinking about Sally Sue or who do you? You meditating on the word. So that means now I'm being occupied behind something that occupies me. And if I'm occupied, he who mine is stayed on thee will be kept. So I'm kept. Why? Because I'm meditating on something that can keep me. We don't want to make this thing difficult. It's not hard. But watch this now, what he said. See, because we want to get to the book of Acts, you know. Yes. You know, and I'm gonna inject some things to you because you're gonna understand. You know, if they have the ears to understand, they'll understand. But other than that, it'll be just basic, just a word. You know, God is looking for a place that he could do what he does best, and that's to reach his people. That's what he's looking for. If I'm an extension of God, then God is looking for me. And God wants to hire me to do some things for him. All right? Okay, so then, you just got through seeing how he equate us to Jesus. You know, the same thing he said to us when you read in Hebrews, he was talking to Jesus. Made us a little lower, but crowned us with glory and honor and put all things under our feet. And I want you to see, okay now, just what I said. Meditate on all things being under your feet. Meditate on that. You know, if you can get into your psyche, because it's how you perceive and what you perceive becomes real to you. Sometimes people will make a lie a reality to them because they believe it, you know. And so what you perceive in your mind without the Bible, it becomes a reality to you. That's why you heard me say, if a person, forget about religion, forget about God, anything. If a person desires to be rich and that's all they've got on their mind and that's all they inundate themselves with and that's all they do, they're going to become rich and live a rich life. And in the end, oh, you signed that note. You just said that, you know. So meditate on what it is that you need to have as a foundation that I need to stand on. You know, so then let's just say I meditated on all things under my feet. So all of a sudden now, if I were to think about sickness, you know, then wait a minute. Sickness is under my feet. And then I start thinking about the scriptures. You know, God said, I'm going to have you above only, and you will not be beneath. So then, wait a minute. So if I'm not beneath, something has to be beneath. So not the sickness. No. Sickness has to be beneath me. It has to be under me. So I'm above sickness. No matter what that circumstance is, no matter, I'm just trying to think of some things that you can say. Y'all can help too, that you can say that will maybe try to usurp authority over you. You know, remember the Bible says too, he says, casting down imagination and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge. Do you have the knowledge though? You have to have the knowledge. Exalt yourself against the knowledge of God. The knowledge of God, but I'm saying, do you have the knowledge of God that would try to exalt itself above the knowledge? If you don't have the knowledge, it can exalt itself above what you don't have. That's what I'm saying. You have to meditate on the word. You can, in the Old Testament church, how they operated in the word of God. It wasn't them, it was the word they operated in. They believed the word of God. They wasn't sitting in front of an idiot box all day long, you know, a TV. She said, what's the idiot box? They had that stuff then, you know. And matter of fact, you'll see some stuff take place in these third world countries that you don't see here. Because them folks believe God. Pastor Stephen's son died. He said, there wasn't no ambulance you can call to rush him to the hospital. He said he had to believe God to raise his son back from the dead. I said, man, because they don't have the luxury that we have. You know, we are so caught up and so spoiled to hell. Set up to go to hell. Huh? You know, so what we're saying that you have to get this knowledge into you, you know. You have to have this knowledge. That boy, there's 9,000 scriptures that came through my head right now concerning the same thing I just said. I can't flip to them fast enough, so I'm just gonna act like I didn't see it. I'm gonna act all right. So watch this now. Watch this now. Now we're talking about understanding the authority, and when you understand authority, who gave you the authority? You know that he got to be greater than you. Isn't the police department greater than you? I don't care how crooked they may get, they're still greater than you. A crooked officer can still take you to jail, you know? But he still has the authority, even though he may be crooked. Like some folks be in the church, they're crooked. You know, in the church, they're crooked. Crooked crooks in the church. Crooked crooks in the church. Huh? Hope they get it together, though. Now, watch, he made a statement here, and I'm gonna take you to it, and I want to show you how he went about this. Now I want us to go to the book of Acts, and in the book of Acts we're going to look at Acts 1, and I know we want to go to 8, but I think we might want to go above 8. Yeah, okay. Let's start at 1, like I said, because somebody told me, man, pastor, this Bible study, read it. Read the whole scripture. Read the whole thing. We're going to go from 1 to 8. You know, the former treaties have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and to teach. Jesus began to do what? Both to do and to teach. You know why he got put out of the synagogue, out of the church? Because he was doing things that they couldn't do. They couldn't do it because they didn't have what he had. I'm going to say that again. The reason why they got mad at Jesus, they called him a rebel. He worked against the grain because he was doing the righteous thing and they weren't. Folk get mad at you when you start doing what's right. Yeah. People get mad at you when you start doing what's right. What make you better than me? Oh, yeah. Until the day in which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after the passion by many infallible proof, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. He didn't say nothing about the Baptist church or the Methodist church. He said pertaining to the kingdom of God. This is the first church that he poured himself out into, and this was the establishment of the first church. So if we want to have church, we have to do it according to the book of Acts. Because after Jesus demonstrated, that's why they call it the Acts of the Apostles. They started acting like him, you know. And so he says, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait. Wait for what? Wait for the promise of the Father, which said he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, will thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? See, there was a little off now, but they knew that he came to do some great works and to restore, but they were looking at the wrong thing. Huh? See, I'm going to leave that alone. Okay. In verse 7, and he said unto them, it is not for you to know the time or the season which the Father had put in his own power. Then he went down. This is where I wanted us to be, because this is where a lot of folks are not. But you shall receive power when? After the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and you shall be a witness unto me both in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth. Why? When? When after the Holy Ghost come upon you. Now, you would think that everybody got the Holy Ghost. They got a portion of the Holy Ghost. But the baptism of the Holy Ghost is what a lot of people, let me show you, a lot of people are missing. They're missing the baptism of the Holy Ghost. John baptized on the water to repentance. Water, repentance on the water simply means it is an outward appearance of an act that took place on the inside of you. It's demonstrate what took place for the world to see. Boosh, take you on the water, bring you back up out of the water and stuff, you know, so you're demonstrating what supposed to have taken place on the inside of you. It didn't take place on the inside of a lot of people, even though they went down on the water and came back up. That still didn't mean nothing. You needed something on the inside of you to show you that you had made a change. Yes. Something to prove to you that you're not the same person no more. That was the baptism. Yes. That's where the power is. Yes. That's where transformation take place on the inside. That's what we're talking about, the dunamis power. The dunamis power is a power that actually changes things. It blows things up that you can't blow up. Amen. It takes apart things that you can't take apart. And it's an actual working of the Spirit of God on the inside of you, moving things out of place that was in place and blocking you from being who you were called to be. Amen. Huh? That's why Jesus made a statement. He said, I came for those that were bruised, brokenhearted, and so. Those are things that's on the inside of people. And the Holy Ghost is the one that worked on the inside, not on the outside. Yes. Dumb folks that Jesus was coming against when he went inside the synagogue, they had on these long robes and stuff and all kind of jewelry on and all kind of high hats on and stuff and walking around holy and stuff like that. And look, you know, and Jesus went inside it and embarrassed all of them. Your hand is with it. Stretch your hand out. And the man stretched his hand up again. What this man is doing on this day? Don't y'all know that man's family would have been glad his hand got straightened out?
Yes.
Why would they get mad when something was done good in the house of God?
Yes.
Oh, it's called common. It's called common, isn't it? Not karma, common sense. That you would want to see. If a man donkey fell inside a ditch and they went and pulled that donkey out, they did it, but nobody else could. Religion. He said, what are you doing pulling that donkey out of that ditch? And they called the man a donkey too. They were good at doing stuff like that. Jesus said, you know, you blocking the way for folks to come in, and you yourself wouldn't even go in. That's what that was the church that he was challenging. And do you know, when church don't become what it's called to be, that's what the church turns into?
That's right.
When they don't do what they are called to do, that's what the church will become. A bunch of whitewashed sepulchers, dead man bones. So God is saying, I'm not going to bring someone that's dying to a hospital that can't help them. I'm not going to do it. It was a hospital out there on 95th Street. It's a hospital that they, if you go there, boy, you may not come back out. I'm serious. I went to that hospital one time looking for my sister-in-law, and when I looked, they had the wrong chart at the foot of the bed. They had two patients when they had the wrong chart at the foot of the bed. I said, hold on a minute, I said, no, that's, and they changed the chart on it. Hey, they getting ready to amputate some stuff off you, because they don't know that. They don't know they had the wrong. And then there's another one they closed down right up here at the Cloverleaf. That big old hospital, they closed that down because they had a whole bunch of foreigners working there that didn't know what they were doing. Golden Glaze. They shut that thing down. Another big hospital that was a bunch of mass confusion. I'm just using this as a replication. It's closed. And they about to close too if they keep on going the way they're going. And so churches that are like that too, shut down. If they are still open, it's a death tomb. It's people coming there to die. When you start telling the truth, you got to be careful, because you're going to create enemies when you start telling the truth, because folks ain't going to like you. And when you hold fast to it, it makes you a dangerous threat to the enemy. I know I'm crossing a lot of lines right now. You know, I wasn't scared in the world, and I ain't scared now. Huh? So then he's saying you're going to receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Now watch this power. We're going to label this power later on, but watch this power. Watch this now. I want you to see this. Look at this. I'm going to show you somebody that understood it real quick, which is this the Roman soldier. And let's go to Luke 7. Luke chapter 7, and start at verse 1. I got to show you this, you know. I read that before, okay, but you ain't understood it. Or you didn't meditate on it. You just didn't even meditate on it. Luke 7. Amen. And look what he says here. Now when he had ended all his sayings in the audience of the people, he entered into Capernaum, and a certain centurion servant who was dear unto him was sick and ready to die. He was sick and ready to die. The man did not come to the synagogue because he knew that they were already dead in the synagogue, and he didn't have enough money to pay them anyway. Some of y'all got that. And when he heard of Jesus, he sent unto him the elders of the Jews, beseeching him that he would come and heal his servant. And when they had came to Jesus, they besought him instantly, saying that he was worthy of whom he should do this, for he loveth our nation, and he had built us a synagogue. Then Jesus went with them, and when he was now not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to him, saying unto him, Lord, trouble not thyself, for I am not worthy that thou should enter under my roof. Wherefore, neither thought I myself worthy to come unto thee, but say in a word, and my servant shall be healed. Doesn't that sound like Mary? Mary said, you know, Mary didn't understand, but she said, be it unto me according to your word. You know, because see, it's some things that you're not going to understand that God going to bring you up against. But if you try to understand it, understanding may be beyond you. But if you just agree to it being who he is and agree to him, then you'll understand more than what you understood when you see the results of you just agreeing. A lot of things that will challenge us, if we would just agree to God, there's some things I can't even explain, but I'm going to just say yes to God. And elder might say, well, Pastor, what are we going to do? I said, well, I don't know. I just say yes. Come on, let's walk. Well, where are we going? I don't know. But we going. That wasn't Moses like that? Yeah. Moses came there, you know, Moses and the Red Sea and the army behind them. And, you know, but if they would have stopped and said, wait a minute, there's a fire behind us holding up these people. So God must be getting ready to do something, you know. And so then Moses had a time to say, hey, Moses, what are we going to do? You know, Moses, what are we going to do? Moses said, God, it's a lot of stuff going on. These people don't believe me and stuff. You got to do something right now, God. God said, what you got in your hand? He said, a stick. He said, raise it up. Now, if Moses said, what a stick going to do?
Yeah.
Moses said, he told me.
Yeah.
And then some stuff that a man wouldn't just do because it won't make no sense.
Yeah.
It wouldn't make sense. But when you do it, then God will show you the super in a natural.
Yeah.
That stick was natural, but God did something. Oh, man. That's why I'm just crazily doing things, and I don't know, and I may not have no answer.
Right.
You know, I can't explain this, but come on, let's go. But, man, you seen so-and-so got ran over. Well, we ain't going to get run over. Come on, let's go.
Right.
You know, now the one that may be scared, well, I can't do that.
Yeah.
Okay, then you stay there. I'm gone.
Right.
I'm gone. Why? Because I'm going to believe God. And I'm going to come before God saying, I believe you. If I got ran over, I said, God, I was believing you, boy. Why you let me get run over?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Shoot. I started to tell that joke about the lady that died and went to heaven. And she wanted some more time. And God sent her back. Not really that long. Woo. Where are we? Verse what? 7. Wherefore, neither thought I myself worthy to come unto thee, but say the word. Now we're talking about he's going to show you power. I mean, he's going to show you first authority, which was in him. He understands authority. And then all he's saying now, I believe the word because of the authority that I understand. So he goes on to say, for I also am a man set under authority. So he's saying something right here. He says, I have under me soldiers. You can say, I have under me spirits, angels. I have working under me. That's what he's saying, all right? So he's saying, I understand, Jesus. You ain't got to come under my roof because I know I'm not a tither. I don't come to church on a regular basis, but I understand who you are. God loves that, boy. When a person just say, man, I understand you. I may not serve you like everybody else serve you and be all out doing all these different things, but I believe you. I respect you.
Yes.
Huh? When I was in the world, man, we used to pull inside a church on a holiday or something like that. Pull inside, man, put that stuff down. Put them drugs down. Let's give God something. I don't know what, but let's give him something. Y'all be quiet, but bow your head down. Ain't nobody said no prayer or nothing, but we were trying to get, we were by the church giving God, I did that a lot of times. Everybody got quiet and stuff in the car, you know. I may have stayed a little too long, so I, okay, let's go. We went on and got high, you know. And I believe because of that, God saw something in me because I wanted God, but I didn't know how to get to God. I saw folks with their suits on and stuff and looking all nice going to church and looking holy and stuff like that. And then I saw them again and I said, oh, man, is that Sister So-and-so that just came out of the church? Is that her? All jacked up over there with Spooty Boy? Oh, man, dang. I thought she was, wow. Maybe it's a separate thing. Go to church and then you go do what you've been doing. That's what I thought in my mind. You know, but you go to church. You know, but I didn't want it. Something inside me said that still don't look right.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want that. So I'm going to wait. I'm going to wait till I see something real.
Yeah.
You know, those were Pharisees and Sadducees and stuff, man. You know. For I also am a man set under authority, having under me, now you understand, soldiers, having under me angels. I have angels under me.
Okay.
You know, so now you're going to understand the authority of who you're under. and how that lines up. And I say unto one, go. I say unto one, bring healing. And I say unto another, goeth. And another, cometh. And he cometh. And to my servant, do this. And he doeth it. And when Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him and turned about and said unto the people that followed him, I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in. He called the man understanding authority great faith. You see that? Because the man understood. Now, I just told you what the authority, the setup of the authority is: God, yes, then man, yes, and then God's angels, and then the demonic angels underneath your feet. All things are under subjection under you. And so God, man, what is man that thou hast made him a little lower than God himself? Amen. Elohim. Amen. Himself. And then the angels under you, amen, that work for you. I say to this angel, go do this. I say to that angel, go do that. I say, Didn't Jacob do that when he set that ladder up that went to heaven? He decided to do some things, and he said, wait a minute, he had this dream, and God was trying to show him the authority that came from above. And he said he had this dream. Now, that dream lined up with Psalms 103 and 20. Psalms 103 and 20. The angels of the Lord encamped around about those that fear God and they do his will, hearkening to the voice of his word. Jacob was lying down and had a dream. There was a ladder extended up to heaven, and God was at the top of the ladder, and angels were ascending. Ascending, not descending, but they were us going up first and then coming back down. Angels that started to work for him, it was showing him his authority, his ability that he had under God. This year in the United States of America, under God. That's why this country is so powerful, because they put themselves under God. At least the expression was under God. They would be like the seven sons of Sceva. Didn't know, but they put themselves under something that could protect them, but they couldn't stay there because they weren't who they say they were. So then, the soldier was showing, he was showing that he understood how this authority worked. So now, when we put ourselves under the authority of God, remember what I said, meditate? If you just let this be a night that you just came to church and, I seen the scriptures, I was, it's a pretty good word and stuff, you know, I'm going to go home now and then lay down, that's it. But you know what? If you were to go and start thinking about it, when you start thinking about it, you're actually showing God that I'm putting forth an effort to hide and set this thing up in me, because I heard what you said to me, and now I want to establish this thing in me. So I'm going to meditate on this. You know, I respect you as being the only ultimate authority in the entire universe, and I'm under you. That simply means now I have authority where I thought I didn't have authority. I remember one time, you know, y'all remember from me now, okay? I remember one time I was about to pay a young guy that came from Guyana, you know, came over. He wanted to come over here for the first time, and we had him come over here and set him up. He started working over here. He stayed over here for about, 2 or 3 months? He stayed over here because he wanted to experience America. Everybody wanted to come to America, land of the brave and opportunity, the land of the free, the land of the free and the brave. Yeah, the land of opportunity. You can go to America and become rich, you know, and everybody believed that, you know. So he wanted to come over here, and so then he worked over here, so it was time for him to go back, and I had some money in my pocket from the church to give to him to go back. So I was coming out of my yard, and as I was walking down, walking through the garage, and he was out front, and I'm walking on through, and I said, God, you know, I didn't say it out of my mouth. I whispered, like, you know, I said, darn, I said, when I give this money to this guy, I ain't gonna have not a damn in my pocket. They're like that. But I didn't say it. If you were standing, you wouldn't have heard me saying that. But the funny thing about it, God heard me. And all of a sudden, my neighbor down the street pulled up in his truck right in front of me and stopped, jumped out, and said, "Man, him, pray for me." Lay $50 on my hand and got in the truck and pulled off. And I said, "God, I was just kidding." I said, "Dang, this man, something." The man heard me whispering. He heard me whispering. And I said, "Golly, boy, you something else, God." I slipped that $50 in my pocket and just, you know, but I, you know, it wasn't something I was just saying it, you know. It wasn't like I wanted some money, you know, like I needed some money. But he heard what I was saying, and he was trying to show me, "I hear you. When you even whisper, I know your thoughts are far off."
Yes.
That know what that means? Not your thought in your head. He said, "The thoughts you have are far off. Before they get into your head, I know them." That's the kind of God we serve. He's an awesome God, man, you know. And the thing about it, he's on your side. That's the incredible part. He's on your side. He's in favor of you. Imagine him being your enemy. Where would I go to get from him? If I make my grave in hell, there you are. If I go up in there, way up in the highest part of the cloud, you're there too. You're everywhere. I can't get away from you. So you better make him your friend. Shoot. You better make him your friend. Or you sure can't get away from him. But watch this power. Let me show you a power. We got a few more minutes. Let me show you some of this power. You know, let's look at Acts again. Let's look at Acts, because remember I said Acts is a church that we should be patterning ourselves behind Acts, you know. And the book of Acts, let's look at Acts 12. In Acts 12, we want to pick up on verse. Okay, let's look at Acts 12. Let's go from 1 to 12, I guess. Acts 12, 1 to 12. "Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hand and vexed certain of the church." That's just some people trying to come against the church. They're doing it today. Y'all know it. Herod is right now coming against the church today. He said, "And he killed James," oh my God, "the brother of John, and with the sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also." Well, "unleavened bread, and when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quadrants of that's a lot of soldiers, y'all. Four quadrants of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him." Now I want you to see now. This is the corporate prayer that we pray, you know. And if when you get on that prayer line, we always said that if you just get on the prayer line and just say amen, you can mute your phone but say amen. You're saying I'm in agreement. Sometimes we have 8, 9, 12 people on the trail. If them 8, 9, 12 and there's one person praying, you say, "Amen. Amen." You know, I'm in agreement. The devil sees that, you know, and you on prayer with God. And so now, since he sees that they are unifying themselves together. They're coming together. And so now it becomes more of a mass now. That's like 1 put 1,000 to flight, 2 put 10,000 to flight. Then when you start to be in agreement, things start to change and stuff start to happening. It all depends on what you're asking God for. So we ain't got to pray about a church building. We can pray some specific prayers, you know. I've been praying about some marriages, and when I got off the line, I'm still praying about marriages and stuff. Why? Because marriages are under attack.
Yes.
You know when things are under attack, when it happened in your house, and it ain't just happening, you ain't that special.
Amen.
You know, it's happening in a lot of other folks' houses too, because when the winds of adversity come, the storm ain't hit just one house, it's going to hit a whole bunch of houses at one time.
Right.
It's just that the one that's the strongest be the one that's going to stand.
Amen.
You know? I don't believe y'all believe me. But you know what? If I have to walk this thing by myself, I'm going to do it. I ain't had nobody with me when I was out there in the world. I was a loner by myself. Folk just attached themselves to me and stuff, you know, but I didn't need to have them. I had my own mind, my own direction, and what I wanted to do, and did it. My dad said, you ain't gonna tell on yourself. He's always say that, boy, you ain't gonna tell on yourself. And I kept that as a motto. Huh? Where we at, five? Peter therefore, six? Okay, the church was six. And when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door kept the prison. Peter was in solitary confinement. Two soldiers right on the side of him, chained up, doors locked, soldiers on the outside of the door, everywhere. It's impossible for him to get out of this situation. Humanly impossible. Okay? And see, we're not talking about humanly things now. Because we got the Holy Ghost, because we waited on that power to come from on high, now you should be able to do with power from high. Now you got an ability now to do things that are supernatural. You know, so, and these laws transcends and takes care, I don't care what it is. Amen. These laws, when you start believing these laws and you start seeing the hand of God more physically, and when I say physically, you will start to see a demonstration of the power more physically than you would if you didn't believe it. Try them sometime and see what happened. Yes. With the impossible. Yes. Oh, gee. Yes. This ain't no fake. And he says, verse 7, and behold, the angel that worked for us, one of them workers came, worker came of the Lord, came upon him, and a light shined in the prison. Woo! And he smote Peter on the side. Now, I'm going to tell you another testimony. You know, because I like to make this thing real. You know, because this is the God that I serve. I was working at this hospital, this private hospital on a commercial. Yeah. Federal highway down there. On the federal highway, it was a private hospital. And the reason why I started working is because they were paying me good. You know. And I was working down in this private hospital, and they had only special people. They had celebrities came to this place. People that had money came there. And so I was working the night shift. You know, because I was working another job in the daytime. You know, we were trying to get there, me and my wife. We made an agreement, we're going to get there if we have to do this together. So I'm working, she working. And so I'm working the day, I'm coming here, I'm working at night. So at night I got the chart. And the head nurse that was working there, she was like an atheist. She knew that I was saved. I didn't say it, but she knew it. And she was trying her best to try and get rid of me. She did not like me, boy, but I'm going to tell you about people that don't like you when they get in trouble. I'm going to show you what's going to happen. So I'm dying there, and I'm sitting now in front of the TV, and I got the chart in my hand, and I'm charting. Sleep. Dead sleep. The doors that I was working at, they were big double doors because I was in the area where they had these patients that was uncontrollable that I controlled. Uncontrollable. But when I put that prayer on them, I'm gonna tell you something happened. When the nurse and the doctors came to introduce me when I was first coming on the job, you know, so I'm coming through the ward and stuff, and they open the doors up, and all of a sudden this kid run up to me, oh no, not you, oh no, and ran down and fell on knees and started bowing down and stuff, and I felt horrible. They said, you know him? You know? I said, nope, but it sounded like I was lying. It sounded like I seen him someplace out of and oh no, not you. I said, oh, that's making me look real bad. Boy, he was talking about the Spirit of God that he saw in me. And I read that in the Bible. When they saw Jesus, man, they went and bowed down to his feet. I said, oh man, that's making me look bad. You know? But anyway, I said to sit that little part. That was the same place I was going. So I'm back and I'm asleep. I am asleep. Dead sleep. All of a sudden, remember I said the doors make a lot of noise when you open it. You can't open it easy. I don't know how she did it, but she cracked that door open real easy and came in there. I didn't hear a sound, but guess what? She was creeping down the hall and to turn the corner to catch me sleeping, and guess what happened at that time? Something did like this. And I walked straight up, and when I walked straight, I had the chart in my hand, the pit in my hand. When I woke up, I looked right at her, looking around the door. She saw me. I looked right in her eyes, and she felt bad. So she came on out. made herself known. I said, oh, she was trying to catch me. But the Holy Ghost woke me up. Now, all right. Now, that wasn't enough. The next night, in the same place, sleep. And then she watched and she said, well, I missed it. Boy, that Holy Ghost man protected him. I did the same thing. And she was doing the same thing, and the same thing happened. The Holy Ghost hit me on my shoulder and woke me up, and I looked right at her again. And after that, she was so embarrassed until she stopped doing it. Now, later on down the line, she had some stomach problem where she had surgery, and she started to bleed, and so she was worried. Guess who she came? She came to me. Came down and sat down and humbled herself down and sat down and stuff, you know. She said, I'm about to go and have some more surgery, and I had some, and it went wrong, and they found bleeding on the inside. And she said, could you pray for me? Nope. 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 Yes. I went on and held her hand and prayed for her. And I didn't feel no kind of animosity or nothing, because I knew God was trying to show her something in the midst of all that. But the thing that got me when I stopped and I thought about that, I said, wait a minute. I said, wasn't nobody inside there? And I ain't had time to, what was that? Who was that? You know, I was in the spirit when it happened. So I didn't recognize or had time to analyze, because I was in the spirit. So it wasn't nothing that was unnatural, because I was in the supernatural. Amen. Some of y'all. Amen. Amen. Yes. Amen. Let's finish reading this right here, because I just had to get a testimony, because I'm saying we live on testimony. She got a testimony. I'm sitting right here. And she just woke that testimony up just when it happened. Yesterday. Just yesterday. She got into an accident, and she said, I'm going to be like Pastor. I'm not going to get her. And she was in the wrong. I'm not going to get a ticket. And guess what? She didn't get a ticket. And she was in the wrong. But she didn't get a ticket. Now, didn't the ticket give a ticket? Shouldn't he give somebody a ticket? Somebody should have got a ticket in it. You see? But she challenged in the supernatural, the natural circumstances, and she didn't get the ticket. You know? Now, I don't know how you want to dissect stuff, you know, but I be coming from a place where when I talk about stuff, it's stuff that I've encountered. I have testimony. That's why, you know, I will not go back to what I used to do. I will not. I'm going to increase my understanding and knowing who God is, because I know that there's more. I tell my wife, I said, man, there's so much more God want to show us, but we're not spending time with him. There's so much more he want to show us. We're just not spending time with him. And that's where the power come in. When you spend time with him, then he will now know you more. Or should I say, you will know him more now. You will know him more. Just show him some time. Meditate on what's being said. So let's finish read this, and then we'll close out. So, and Herod would have brought him before the same night. Peter was sleeping between two soldiers bound with chains, and the keeper before the door of the prison. And behold, an angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison and smote him. That's the part that got me, man. I said, man, I understand, because I experienced that. And smote Peter on his side, and arise, raise him up, saying, arise up quickly. And his chains fell off. Huh? From off his hand. The chains fell off. Ain't nobody had no key. The chains fell off. And the angel said unto him, gird thyself and bind on thy sandals. And so he did. And he said unto him, cast thy garment about thee and follow me. And he went out from following him, and wist not that it was true which was done by the angels, but thought he saw a vision. And when they were past the first and the second ward, they came unto the iron gate, and leaded him into the city, which opened to them of his own accord. And they went out and passed on through the streets. And forthwith the angel departed from him, and Peter was come to himself. He came to himself. In other words, he came out of the spirit, and he came to himself, right? And he said, now I know of a certainty that the Lord has sent an angel and had delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews. And when he had considered the thing, he came to his house of Mary, the mother of John, whose name, surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. This is so true and so real. When I read certain parts of the Bible, it just wake up stuff that I experienced in my walk with God, and I know that this is of a truth. And there's so many things, you know, if you start paying God attention and have an expectation from God and putting things before him that may look like it's impossible, God specializes in the impossible. Let us pray. Father, we thank you tonight, Lord God, for being an impossible God. Not to us, but showing the enemy that you can do anything you feel like you want to do. Anything you feel like we need to have. Lord God, we open ourselves up to you, allowing you to just be Lord over all of who we are. We thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you are blessed by today's broadcast and would like to give a donation or love offering to support what we are doing here at New Life Rural Outreach Ministries, the place where love is, please feel free to do so at this time by sewing through our website, nowoministries.com, or through the app Givelify. Thank you, and may God continue to bless you and prosper you in his word.
Givelify is giving simplified. Givelify is the fastest and easiest way to donate to the church, charity, or cause of your choice. You're not limited to the cash you have on hand. There's no need to write checks, and there are no complicated sign-up forms to fill out, websites, or text message codes to remember. Givelify automatically pinpoints your location and intelligently identifies the fundraiser or church service you're attending without the need to search. Since Givelify automatically detects where you are, making a donation can be completed in as few as 3 taps. Tap 1, use one of the pre-configured denominations to specify the donation amount. Tap 2, select the specific campaign to which you'd like to contribute. Tap 3, with your stored credit card, complete your donation in 1 tap. You get an immediate donation receipt, and you can even share your generosity on Facebook or Twitter. Givelify lets you easily see your donation history with any church or charity you donate to. You can also accurately track your donations for your taxes without needing to hunt down receipts, bank statements, or acknowledgement letters. You can also set your home and favorites. Mark churches as your favorites so you can donate as frequently and generously as you'd like, even when you're thousands of miles away. Mark the church you normally attend as your home church for quick one-tap access. Givelify. Tap. Give. Done.
Amen. I got caught up giving. Y'all forgive me. I was just giving. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6.
Trust in the Lord with all thy heart, and lean not to thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy
God bless you, and have a Holy Ghost night.